make a few announcements. One is we received at our annual conference Vital Congregations recognition. And it says, this special recognition is presented to Antrim UMC for reaching or surpassing 2012 Vital Congregation goals. And it says, for weekly attendance. Now, I know we surpassed all the goals, all five. Weekly attendance, professions of faith, small groups, mission giving, and there's a fifth one. But I'm going to give this to Mert. She is a representative at annual conference, and we got this at annual conference. So, hopefully next year, if we get all the reports in, we will get recognition for the other five areas, for the other four areas. And well, let us get started, and we'll continue a little later. Follow me with a call to worship. Praise the Lord.
Let all be brought forth. Praise the Lord.
Happy are those whose help is from God, the one who made heaven and earth, the one who created the seas and all that is in them.
Happy are those whose hope is in God, the one who keeps faith forever, the one who feeds the hungry and defends the oppressed.
God will reign forever, for all generations. Praise the Lord.
Let all be brought forth. Praise the Lord.
Let us now repeat our opening prayer together. O God, who lifts us up,
sets us free, and watches over us, visit us this day. Lift our spirits and free our minds. Open our eyes and hearts to your words, your will, and your miracle and your holy presence, that we may encounter you in the meeting of friends and in kindness to strangers. Lift us up and set us free, O God. Watch over us, we pray. Amen.
Please stand and sing hymn number 101 from all. We'd like to share our joys and sorrows. And together as children of God, we weep with those who weep, we mourn with those who mourn, and we rejoice with those who rejoice. I just wanted to mention one other thing. Taylor Clark, who's probably known by several of you, took part in the Miss Teen Kansas yesterday. And I'm looking forward to her doing it next year, and tremendous support from the church. There are others there, like Miss Wichita, who had either her whole church or half of Wichita there with her. And she came out, they were loud chairs. I don't think many of us knew Taylor Clark was taking part in this, or else I'm sure we would have been there to support her. But she was the youngest one, so I wouldn't expect her to win Miss Teen Kansas until she's 17, 18, something like that. But it was a joy to be there. Dorothy and I went to that yesterday. We also went to Lincoln, Nebraska for their annual conference, which I thought was just excellent. Very, very good. As good as ours. But we came back safely. Thank God for that. Okay, other joys and cares and concerns and victories.
Well, last weekend we got to be with all of our grandchildren.
Yes.
Wonderful. In Kansas.
All how many?
Five. All five. And our son and our daughter.
Great.
Yeah, that was wonderful.
Yes. Yes.
Yes. I want to remind everybody that we're working on the dresses on Wednesday afternoon. We've got several started. So we'll continue on.
Where would you be working on?
Downstairs.
Downstairs. Need any supervisors? Factory managers?
No. Thank you anyway.
You can just keep them back from doing their work.
Wednesday.
Chelsea's planning to be here next Sunday with a couple of her friends, and they plan to sing. So,
great.
Yes. They're coming here for birthday week. We all have birthdays
the
following week.
Yeah, okay. I can think somebody's got a birthday the next week, they could come back again. Okay, anyone else? Let us, I'm looking at the bulletin, see what's in there that's special. Okay, let us go to God in prayer. Oh God, today we come before you and we're your servants. We ask that you bless those people who are affected by tornadoes, any disasters, hurricanes. Especially we ask you to look on the friends in Oklahoma, Lord, and comfort them and provide for them. We enter your presence, gracious God, with reverence for your holy. We enter with gratitude for your good. We enter with awe, for you are the triune mystery which we cannot begin to fathom. You are transcendent, majestic, yet as eminently near as our next breath and our prayer. You call us your beloved children. You know each of us by name. You know each of us, our every need, our every wound, our every thought. Our days are in your hands. Embrace us, we pray, that we might rest peacefully in your loving arms. comforted by your compassion and buoyed or lifted up by your hope and our hope. Lord, we ask all these things in Jesus' name. Father, we ask that you bless each and every person who is here today. Bless those who would love to be here but cannot be here. Bless those who are taking part in games today. We ask that you be with them, strengthen them, keep them whole, help them to play well, to be able to come back with a reasonable portion of health and strength. Lord, we ask a blessing in our community. Teachers who are at home recuperating from the summer, the term that's just finished, and some are going into the summer term. Ask a blessing on all our students, all our law and caregivers. We ask a blessing on our president and the cabinet and all those in charge of all government institutions above us, including our city and county governments. Father, we ask that you bless those who are in charge of the services, that they would see fit to bring our soldiers home quickly and expeditiously. Father, we thank you for blessing us so richly. We ask a special blessing on America, Lord, and we ask that you forgive her of her sins and transgressions. We ask that you prosper her, Lord. Her put to be the light that you've set her to be on a hill, a light that gives light to those in darkness. Bless us, in Jesus' name we pray, who taught us how to say our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Please turn with me to hymn 274.
Peace is all.
it up at verse 11, chapter 7, 11 through 17. Last week we read, it's found on page 65 of the Pew Bible at the back. Last week we read the first 10 verses, and it was Jesus healing the centurion's slave. And we're going to pick it up at verse 11. And it just continues to show the miracles and the power of Jesus Christ, who is God. Listen to the word of God as it comes to you from Luke chapter 7, 11 through 17. Soon afterwards, this is after he had healed the centurion's slave, Jesus went to a city called Nain. And his disciples and a crowd went with him. As he drew near to the gate of the city, behold, a man who had died was being carried out, the only son of his mother. And she was a widow, and the large crowd from the city was with her. And when the Lord saw her, he had compassion on her, and said to her, "Do not weep." And he came and touched the bier, and the bier stood still. And he said, "Young man, I say to you, arise." And the dead man sat up and began to speak. And he gave him to his mother. Fair seized them all, and they glorified God, saying, "A great prophet has arisen among us, and God has visited his people." And this report concerning him spread through the whole of Judea and all the surrounding country. Please turn with me in your Pew Bibles to the book of Galatians, and it's found on page 177. Galatians 177. And again, we read the first 10 verses of Galatians last week, and it was Paul telling the Galatians that, you know, I taught you a pure gospel. Why are you believing these people, these Judaizers who are coming in and corrupting what I taught you? So it continues from verse 11. Galatians, chapter 1, verses 11 through 24. "For I would have you know, brethren, that the gospel which was preached by me is not man's gospel. For I did not receive it from man, nor was I taught it, but it came through a revelation of Jesus Christ. For you have heard of my former life in Judaism, how I persecuted the church of God violently and tried to destroy it. And I advanced in Judaism beyond many of my own age among my people. So extremely zealous was I for the traditions of my fathers. And when he who had set me apart before I was born and had called me through his grace was pleased to reveal his son to me in order that I might preach him among the Gentiles, I did not confer with flesh and blood. Nor did I go up to Jerusalem to those who were apostles before me. But I went away into Arabia, and again I returned to Damascus. Then after 3 years, I went up to Jerusalem to visit Cephas and remained with him 15 days. But I saw none of the other apostles except James, the Lord's brother. And what I'm writing to you before God, I do not lie. Then I went into the regions of Syria and Sicilia, and I was still not known by sight to the churches of Christ in Judea. They only heard it said, 'He who once persecuted us is now preaching the faith he once tried to destroy.' And they glorified God because of me." May the words of my lips and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. From those two passages, I want to direct your attention to living victoriously. Victorious living. Living a life of victory in Jesus Christ. Living that life of victory in and through and because of Jesus Christ. Well, you just heard me read about the widow of Nain. And Jesus is moved by a widow's plight. He came in and saw this large funeral procession, and he was moved and filled with compassion. You see, sons are not supposed to die before mothers. That's not the normal way. Mothers and fathers come along and they have their children. Mothers and fathers die and their children take care of their children. Then they die and their children live on. But every one of us know of a situation that was not what we would consider to be normal. But Jesus becomes an agent of miracles, showing holy love for those who have no refuge in society. Imagine, let's imagine, even today, a woman coming up, well, a girl coming up, and she's, I don't know, 17 or 18, and she has a baby, and she gets married, and after a while, she brings up her kids. Well, in this case, one son, then her husband dies. Then her son dies. And she's left, no college education, no education, no degrees, no any way of taking care of herself. She has to rely on the mercy of people giving her alms. It happens even today. In lesser societies, I don't know how to call that, but other societies other than ours, where women have no choice. And so is this mother there crying. I want you to imagine or look at or try to remember a picture of the Pietà. Michelangelo painted this picture of Mary with her dead son in her arms. I don't know if I'm sure we've all seen that picture of the Pietà, Michelangelo's mother looking at her dead son. The apparently effortless power of death comes in to rob us, comes in to annihilate us, comes in to make us humble, comes in to hurt us, comes in to embarrass us. But Jesus changes all that. Jesus walks into the city and says to the young man, I say, rise. And the dead man, the Bible is correct in what it says, the dead man got up, he looked around, and he started speaking. People were shocked. People were amazed. And they said, well, maybe a prophet is here with us. Well, it's always exciting to meet new Christians, you know, meet a new convert to anything. Anyone that's just been converted, you know, you could be a member of Lions for 20 years and you never tell anyone, and somebody comes in, and the next day he or she's out there, and they're telling you, you gotta be a Lion, you gotta be a Christian, you gotta be something. You gotta come into my organization. And they come in with enthusiasm and contagious power, and they come in eager to tell the world, in this case, about Jesus. And this was Paul. Paul was dramatically converted. And you know the story. He was going to get all the Christians in jail. And he was going through Damascus to get some more Christians to jail him and kill him. And he was there standing up with Stephen's claws on his arm. And they're stoning Stephen to death. And he was doing what he thought was God's will. And Jesus, Paul must have been very important for Jesus to leave heaven, to come down and punch him in the head and knock his head off and say, hey, I want you on my team. He was very important. I can't recall any other story where Jesus left heaven, came down and got a man or a woman and recruited them to be on the battlefield for him. Paul realized that he was specially selected even before his birth. And some of us are blessed. Some of us have volunteered whether God selected us or not. We're gonna preach the word, and some of us have been selected even before our birth. And Paul was one of those. And he knew that once he had Jesus Christ on his side, Jesus Christ told him then and there, you're going to live a victorious life, but you're going to have to suffer many, many things for me. You're going to have to go through a lot. You know, he was beaten 4 times. He received 39 lashes. He was shipwrecked. He was dropped in Berea. He was dropped out in a basket. Hey, Paul, we're going to drop you outside the city walls. When you get down to the bottom, just run. Don't look back. Just keep going out of here. They're going to kill you if you stay. And Paul went through all of that. And yet he knew he had Jesus Christ with him. And he knew that he was going to lead this victorious life in and through Jesus Christ. So I want to direct your attention to living a victorious life. And my first point, a victorious life is free from the past. A victorious life frees us from what we've done in the past. Now, I'm not speaking to any of you, but I'm sure somebody here has told a lie about somebody. I'm not pointing fingers. And I'm sure somebody has disappointed some others. And I'm sure somebody here has done something that they're not exactly proud of. Somebody's done something that they're, quite frankly, downright ashamed of. Paul viciously persecuted the church. Paul viciously wanted to end the church. He wanted to finish everything about Jesus Christ. He sort of threw people in jail. He got them stoned to death. He did all this bad stuff. But when Jesus Christ came into his life, when he got the word of Jesus Christ, his encounter with the risen Savior on the Damascus Road, he became one of the greatest converts in the history of Christianity. God was pleased to reveal his son, Jesus Christ, to Paul, that he might proclaim Jesus Christ among the Gentiles. He was the apostle to the Gentiles. Jesus told him that. And he was empowered to go out. And when he did that, he did not even see the apostles, the other apostles. He sent Cephas in the story I just read. That's Peter. He did not see any of them for 3 years, but he engaged in growing in sanctification, reading the Bible. Now he read the Old Testament, which was all that was there, and he saw Jesus in Genesis and Exodus, and he saw what he could not see until the scales were removed from his eyes. And that happens to us, friends. Until we receive Jesus Christ, there are scales in our eyes and we just cannot see. We just cannot love. But Paul was not stuck in the past. He knew I was just such a miserable sinner attacking the very God of the universe. But that did not hold him back. He knew he had an arrogant past. He knew he was really vicious to humankind. And the thing is, once we are proud, once we were all proud and arrogant, but now that we have received Jesus Christ, we have become humble, compliant. We have become available, a vessel of God to be used in God's service. For some of us, our past can be a prison that prevents us from moving forward. And we must move forward into true freedom in Jesus Christ. I'm sure there's something we've done that still haunts us, whatever it is. But I want you to know that whatever we've done, if we come to Jesus Christ and we confess it to Him, the Bible says He's faithful and just to forgive us. No matter what we've done, if we confess it, if we acknowledge it. You know, if you're a member of the AA, you go up and you, I'm dying to go to the AA meeting sometime. I keep saying that. But I understand people stand up and they say, I'm an alcoholic, I'm a drunk. And they admit it. And that comes straight out of the Bible. You confess your sins and then ask Jesus Christ to take over and lead you and guide. So for a victorious life, and life must be free from the past. And then a victorious life has confidence in the present. We live in this present age, and once we have this victorious life, we live with Jesus Christ. And Paul lived a very victorious life. I mean, you look at his past, and look at it when he was writing these letters and living as a Christian. You say, how could that be victorious? He's in jail. He's whipped, he's beaten, he's in stocks, and he's living a victorious life. Yes, in Jesus Christ, we have the victory. You see, the gospel was not preached to him by man, not in any way, but he received this through revelation. And whenever we talk about revelation, we're talking about Jesus Christ revealing himself to Paul, revealing himself to John the Apostle. The Holy Spirit led Paul, not his paradigm, my friends, not his political party rhetoric, not his Jewish polity. See, so many of us just spout out our party's rhetoric, whatever it is. And I'm not saying which side is right, which side is wrong. Both sides are right, both sides are wrong. But we spit out our party rhetoric without saying, what would Jesus do in this case? If this law were passed, would it help the rich? Would it help the poor? Would it hinder the rich? Would it hinder the poor? We just spout out the side in which we happen to find ourselves, whether it hurts the underprivileged or not, when we should be preaching Jesus Christ, we should ask, what would Jesus do? Now, both sides are right at times. Both sides are wrong at times. As Christians, we've got to go with the right. Whether it's our party or the other party. As Christians, we must ask, what would Jesus do? Is this for the good of humankind? Should we continue to seek the approval of man? Or should we continue to look and seek for the approval of God? You see, we cannot please God and man at the same time. That is impossible. Man is interested in me, myself, and I. God says, love God and love your neighbor. And so we must put things through the lens of Jesus Christ. So we can live a victorious life, free from the past. We can live a life with confidence in the present. So what do we have? Past, present, what's next? Future. You can live a victorious life that has hope. Hope for the future. See, when Jesus Christ arose from the dead, and we're not even talking about the poor guy who died in Maine and was Maine and was risen from the dead, he had hope to take care of his mother. He had all kinds of, the mother had hope. Someone would be there to take care of her. But when Jesus Christ rose from the dead, and he is our leader, he's our guide, he's our God, then it gives us the hope that one day we too will arise from the dead, and gives us the hope for the future. Well, news of his conversion, Paul's conversion, preceded him in the churches of Judea. They hadn't even seen him. He just said for 3 years he was out there in Asia preaching to what's we call Turkey, you know, Asia Minor, that part up there, from Damascus all the way across to all the islands, Crete, Greece, and all that area. And for 3 years they heard about this man, Paul. Boy, we remember that guy. He was trying to kill us. He was trying to get rid of the church. But everybody brought a glowing report on how he tried to convert the entire world. And my friends, we don't know what the future holds for each and every one of us. But what we do know is who holds the future. I want to give you some pointers here. When we put Jesus Christ first in our lives, we can do these, some of these things, which this list is by no means exhaustive. But when we put Jesus Christ first in our lives, we can forgive ourselves, we can forgive others, and we can forgive God. So many people can never forgive him because of what he's done to us. Or never forgive her for what she's done to me. I've heard people say, as long as I live, I'll never forgive so-and-so for what he's done. And other people, why did God take my mother? Why did God take my great-grandmother? You know, grandmother is 110, and why did God take her? And some people just never forgive God. Well, if we put Jesus Christ first in our lives, we can let go of the past. You know, I used to be, or I did, or whatever it was, or somebody, you know, she used to be. And we just never forget the past. But in Jesus Christ, we can let go of the past. We can put the past in God's hands. We can nail the past to an old rugged cross. And we can put the past in the hands of a loving Savior who has come. Well, if we put Jesus Christ first in our lives, we can abide in Jesus Christ. What's that mean? John 15:9 says, as the Father has loved me, so I have loved you. Abide in my love. You see, before Jesus Christ, the world did not know love. The world did not know agape love. And one day I really should preach on love and explain that Jesus Christ was the first person that taught us to love. He said, I give you a new commandment that you love. That's brand new, 2,000 years ago. Before that, we tolerated the brother-in-law. We tolerated the sister-in-law. We tolerated our kids. In fact, in Rome, if they wanted, they could kill their kids. They were in charge. There was no love in the world until Jesus Christ came and said, I give you a new commandment that you love. He says, love one another as I have loved you. But that was new. Love has only been 2,000 years old. So we can abide in Jesus Christ. When we put Jesus Christ first, we can worship and pray with our sisters and brothers in Christ. That's why you're here in church today. If you were not Christian and you got God, what you do is you go up on a mountain and you say, om, all day. And you worship God because you got it. You ain't getting it to nobody. You got God as a Christian. You want everybody. You're that new convert. Come on in. I want you to be saved. I want you to live everlastingly. So we can worship and pray with sisters and brothers in Christ, and that's why you're here today. That your sisters and brothers can pick you up. Somebody's had a hard time this week. Somebody's had some bad news from a doctor or something. But you come to church, and your sisters and brothers in Christ pick you up. When we put Jesus Christ first in our lives, we can study the Word and pray. Every time I go over to the Kenwood Nursing Home, I sort of pour out my heart with them and say, look, you guys, you got one big job in the world. You're sitting here. You don't have to get up and rush to work. Somebody takes care of you. Somebody feeds you. Somebody cleans you. Somebody takes care of all of your needs. I want you to do one thing. I want you to pray. That's why you're here. So you can pray for the world. You can pray for each other. You can pray for peace in the world. You can pray for love. You can pray for me. You can pray for my family. Pray. Well, those are some of the things if you have Jesus Christ first in your lives we can do. And just like Paul and Silas, we can be free from the past. Imagine being whipped in stocks and chains and coming out and going back to preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ. I would have said, Lord, you forsook me. You forgot me. You left me in there to suffer and to die. I ain't going back to church no more. Paul did not say that. He came out and he came out with all the zeal that he had that he went to with. So like Paul and Silas, we can be free from the past. We can live confidently in the present and look forward with hope to the future as we live a victorious life. Let us now stand and repeat Apostles' Creed 881. Together, I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Let's continue to stand and repeat our offering prayer together. Let's find the bulletin. As crowds spread the word of Jesus' power, O God, so may we spread the word of your grace as we share these gifts in our very lives with those in need. May these offerings be instruments of your healing, your justice, your good news in this community and around the world. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Please be seated. please stand.
Thank you.